Sandwiched between the highest mountain range in the world and the humid plains of northern India, few countries can boast the beauty of Nepal. But for centuries, this promised land, the only Hindu kingdom in the world, remained a tightly kept secret, forbidden to outsiders. But in the 1950s, after political change at home, Nepal finally began to reopen its doors to the outside world. And before long, the trickle of curious foreigners making their way overland soon became a rush as word spread of the secrets of this forgotten Shangri-La. They came to see the magnificence of its medieval architecture and craftsmanship, the beauty and dignity of its people, and the incredible wealth of its culture. But while the tourist influx brought much-needed wealth and opportunity to a country long mired in poverty, it also coincided with a period of change greater than any the country had seen before. Rubbish began accumulating on riverbanks and on city streets. Century-old temples and palaces fell into disrepair. Great works of art were stolen and smuggled abroad. Meanwhile, the rapid growth in the number of motor vehicles plying Kathmandu's streets produced worsening levels of air pollution. But today there is a growing realization that if Nepal's dynamic and vibrant heritage is to be preserved for future generations, action must be taken now. One of the people leading the way is Bharat Baznet, the founder of Nepal's first ecotourism company and one of the country's most proactive environmentalists. He remembers when he first came to Kathmandu as a boy and began to notice the extraordinary wealth and heritage of Nepali culture.
And then later I started finding more and more detailed work, whether it's woodwork, metalwork, or stonework. And this is amazing wealth of the country. Why are we letting this just go, vanish, right? This is why I'm inspired. I'm sure I had not had any, science background or, environmental background. I would have been lost. I would have not been able to do or bring these issues to the public.
As a direct result of a campaign he initiated, more than 600 high-polluting tuk-tuks were banned from the city streets in 1999 and replaced by electric vehicles. And fed up with the city administration's failure to tackle Kathmandu's growing tide of filth, Bharat organized a clean-up of Kathmandu's Ratna Park. And for the past 2 months, Bharat and his staff, who give their time freely to help with the effort, have spent every Saturday and Sunday morning removing tons of rubbish from the Swambunath Monkey Temple, one of Kathmandu's most important Buddhist sites. He and his staff have their work cut out for them.
This is not bad, because this we can clean up by 2-3 days. But the problem is, whatever underneath the bush is most difficult to take them out. It will take maybe 6 months at least if we continue our process like this. It's really a shame. And I feel really embarrassed to see what we have done to our site.
But despite the literal and metaphorical mountain that they still have to climb, Bharat is confident that ideas and attitudes are changing, and the battle to save Nepal's rich heritage can be won.
What I found is, if we do not keep the fragile nature, right, the ecosystem that we have, and the man-made heritage, then the tourism cannot stand. So we have to be very much eco-minded, and we have to respect our tradition, our culture, and all the monuments that we have. And it's very good that I got an opportunity to learn and understand the importance. So my generation has to work very, very hard to keep this, passing down to the coming generation in a good form.